probably you could ask, and I'll be happy to answer to the best of my abilities. Now, the slide deck is not something comprehensive which you could directly understand everything just by looking at it. It is more for my controlling my flow of talk, and so excuse me if you don't find too many details there. I'll try to cover as much detail as possible. Again, let me remind you, this is not a training session. This is more of a webinar where I shall highlight the interesting aspects of data science, and make you aware of it, so that you gain more interest in that, and get into higher studies with respect to the data. So it's just an introduction at a top level. If you are already a practicing data scientist, please bear with me. You would know everything here. The others, it is for you, and it is to enthuse you to go ahead and learn more about data science. So let me start off with the presentation. So what is data science? Now, a very wrong understanding about data science is that it is more to do with the analytics and machine learning. Now, the first thing one needs to understand is it's a very vast subject related to data. All the aspects of data, starting from the data acquisition, it could be data like a naturally occurring data like weather, where some instrument records it. It could be manually recorded data. It could be the data generated by IoT. Most of our smart cities are using a lot of these technologies to acquire data. It could be a directly measured data, as I said. So the data source could be anything. It could be, for all we know, it could be the output of a survey we conduct by sending out forms online. In the earlier days, it would be a physical form. So data can be generated by any means, and acquiring the data is a part of data science. That is the origin of data. Once we acquire the data, we need to store the data. We need to retrieve the relevant part of the data. So that is the next stage, data storage and retrieval. The third stage is the analysis of the data. Now we take the data which we have acquired and stored. We extract the data from the storage system. We analyze the data by any means. There could be, it could be as simple as drawing a graph or finding the mean, or it could be a very complex system where we try to identify an image or whatever else, generate a news report. It could be anything. And then once we analyze the data, a part of the analyzed data, so it could, my analysis could still just be condensing the data into some sort of a summary part, which will then be analyzed further. So I analyze the data, and there is a possibility that I store it back as a summary. So the data analysis and storage is a two-way arrow, if you see the slide. And ultimately, after all the analysis is done, we get an output. And the last stage is decision making. Now, even in my teaching, I emphasize this part. Ultimately, all this should lead to a decision. It could be a decision taken by a human being based on the analysis and the output of our analysis. It could be a decision which is suggested by our own system. It could be a decision to let's say automate a machine, a robo or robotic arm or whatever. So ultimately, it should lead to a decision. Now, if there is no decision, it is just, you know, we are just doing some analysis, drawing some, you know, really nice graphs, and ultimately we all go home happy to have seen some graphs. It's no use. So the main thing which you need to understand while starting to implement or do some analysis on the data is, what is this data about? What am I trying to analyze? And who is going to benefit from it? Now, these are the three basic fundamental stuff, fundamental points which you need to remember before analyzing the data. Now, one exercise I do in some of my classes is to give a set of data after a few classes, of course, when they have started learning some of the techniques, to give some data, and immediately our urge is to go and analyze the data, do some statistics on that, and come up with some analysis. Now, what we need to realize is, before we even think of doing any analysis on the data, our first item should be, rather the first point should be, what is this data? So do I understand this data, or am I going blind there? We will come to this in a while. Second, what am I analyzing? So what is my business, what is the business need for my analysis? And ultimately, what am I expected to get out of it? And the last one, who is going to benefit? So ultimately, it should lead to a business decision and hence some benefit. Now, the benefit could be tangible, intangible, we'll not bother about that, but ultimately, we need to realize that it should lead to a benefit. Otherwise, you know, there's no point in doing any analysis on any random data we choose. Another point here I want to mention is the data itself in any format. You know, it could be numbers, it could be, you know, text and numbers, it could be voice, it could be some colors, it could be anything. Okay, the data comes in various ways. It could be any combination of all this, and we need to realize that the data could be structured, data could be unstructured. So we need to learn how to analyze all possible sorts of data and make meaning out of that. That in entirety, that is data science. So where is the analytics, machine learning, where does that come? That comes only in this aspect of the analysis which we do. Most of our the well-known aspects of data science comes there. But remember, the other aspects of data science, such as storage, retrieval, now these are also equally important, if not more. Just to give a perspective to that, a lot of analytics and machine learning techniques we use, they are not something which was discovered or something which came up in the recent past. Some of the concepts have been there for centuries. The reason why data science, and in particular data analytics, was not so popular, if I may use the word, was because, number one, we didn't have the capacity to generate that large quantities of data. Electronics was not so advanced to store and retrieve the data. The computational power was extremely low, and so most of it was manual. Because of that, many of these techniques could not be effectively applied. Now, once the electronic revolution started, we started having more computational power. We started, so we could, we also, you know, got data acquisition systems and, you know, IoTs nowadays. So the way to acquire data, because of the boom in electronics, we could acquire more data. We could store more data, we could process more data, and in the recent past, if you see, Now we have distributed databases and all sorts of enhancements in data storage and retrieval, which enabled us to get into this stage where data science has become so advanced. That is one. And so much of it is impactful in our almost everything we do on a daily basis. And so the analytics part has picked up because of the enhancements which happened in the other aspects of data science, which is the hardware aspects, the database aspects, the data acquisition aspect, and so on. Going forward, I want to advise the students at least. I'm sure the others who are practicing will already be aware of it and would have already developed it to a large extent. Need to have a mindset to be a good data scientist. Perseverance, that is one thing which is absolutely required. The data, the raw data, if you see from any system when you acquire, would be a nightmare, if I can call it. Nothing will be so simple. When we start learning data science, we go to a textbook. It is very neatly arranged sample data, which is very well posed, if I may use the word from other aspects of mathematics. And we can immediately apply the concepts we learn on that, understand the concepts. But when you get the data from the ground, it will not be so well posed. You need to do a lot more massaging on the data, a lot more transformation on the data to make it conducive for analysis. For that, you need a lot of perseverance. You need to keep working on the data. You assume something and you start analyzing, and then you find that you're going nowhere, and then you have to go back and start all over again. These things happen. Of course, with experience, you would get to start doing things in a much faster way, because you would know that given the data of this domain, given the data from this background, this is what now you would expect, and so we will become faster. But perseverance is one thing which is a must for a person who wants to pursue data science. The second, and I think even more important one, is common sense. Now we can learn all the we want to. We can learn to use all sorts of tools and applications and products. But if you lack common sense, you always end up with coming to a wrong decisions or coming to a wrong conclusion, which will in turn lead to a wrong decisions. We will take some examples going forward. But one example, let me mention it now. We will take it later again. There is a classic case of correlation between wave height in the Arabian Sea and population of Portugal. Now, if you take these data and if you find the correlation coefficient, you find that it is very high. Now, if you think that we can now build a model to predict the population of Portugal based on the average wave height of the Arabian Sea, you cannot be further away from truth. What you need to also understand is common sense tells us that there is no cause-effect relationship here. One is not causing the other. Just because these numbers appear to be related doesn't mean that we can build a model out of it. So common sense, believe me, is absolutely important. In fact, one of my students asked, so what percentage you assign to all these things? I assigned about 60% of the entire data analytics to common sense, about 25% to remaining 15% to the rest of it, like the domain knowledge, the techniques and technology, and the tools available. By tools, I include all sorts of tools. It could be a simple Excel, or it could be a product like SAS or anything bigger. Now, what we also conveniently forget let us assume a mathematician. I know, you know, a lot of maths, and hence I know all the techniques and technology of data science. I get the data from, let us say, I am an engineer currently. I am working in a group which deals with banking software. Now, if I go and analyze something which is, sorry, madam, if I'm not audible, let me speak. Okay.
Sir, there was a loss of audio for quite a second. So now we are audible. You can continue, sir.
Okay, I'm sorry about that. You know, unfortunately, the internet bandwidth fluctuates.
No problem. You can also do one thing. You can turn off the video for the presentation so that there would be a bandwidth usage there. And while going for a QA session, we can, if you request, we can turn it on. Just you need to click on the video icon next to the speaker button, or the mic button. Yeah, perfect. Yeah.
So I'm on. I hope you can hear me now.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
What I was. Okay. Thank you. What I was saying was, it needs a lot of collaboration. I was giving an example of my knowledge. I did my PhD in stochastic optimization, basically operations research. I work in a group, you know, since 25 years. I have been working in software companies which deal with banking softwares. So I'm an expert in banking. And because I also know data science, if some data is given about healthcare domain, now I know how to analyze the data. But if I take up the healthcare data and try to analyze that, I would more often than not, I would end up with wrong conclusions. The reason is I do not know whether the data makes any meaning or not. Given data makes any meaning or not. Now, let me take an example and I will tell you what I mean by that. It's a simple thing. Let us assume I'm comparing, I'm trying to find a relation between heights and weights of monkeys. Okay, I'm just making it up. Now, I suddenly get, I mean, monkeys are, let's say, you know, 5 kgs, 6 kgs, up to 10 kgs, and go up to, let's say, 1 foot, 1.5 feet height. 1 foot, 1.5 feet height. And suddenly I get about 80 kgs and, or rather 100 kgs and 5.5 feet height. I get one point, which is that. Now, if I am a person, a zoologist, let us say, who knows that height and weight of monkeys can range in this particular range, I would immediately know that this extraordinary outlier number doesn't make any sense. On the other hand, if I'm saying it's a primate, so instead of taking only the monkeys, the primate can include, let us say, a gorilla, that point makes perfect sense. Whereas if I am a banker, and I am trying to do that analysis, whether to consider that point or not would become a major issue for me. And more often than not, because it is way beyond my normal range of data which I have, I would probably ignore it and come to a wrong conclusion. So I should know the data as one of the speakers in a NASSCOM convention pointed out, I should be intimate with the data. I should know the physical meaning of the data. Otherwise, I should not even bother to analyze that. So, if someone told me that the temperature at a given place is related to the flow in a river, let us say a stream flow, we call it. My background is hydrology. I would immediately say that is not a very possible situation, because stream flow, there could be some evaporation, but it is not directly related to temperature. Most probably it would be related to how much water is available in the groundwater table. So unless you are close to the data which you are analyzing, it would be more often than not, it would lead to erroneous decisions. So does that mean that I take only banking data and analyze and any other data I ignore? Obviously not, because I'm a data scientist, I cannot ignore other data. I would collaborate. I need to have a domain expert next to me who can tell me whether what the data means. And once I do a model and once I predict, he will tell me whether that makes any sense or it is absolute utter nonsense. So I collaborate with people who know the domain, people who know the other aspects of data science, like let us say data retrieval from a computer. I must be an analytics person who know the techniques of analyzing a data. So perseverance, common sense, collaboration are the absolute requirement for going ahead with data science. So, continuing. So, many people ask me, is programming necessary? Do I need to be good in programming? So, there was this HR lady who attended one of my courses and asked me, do I need to know programming? Otherwise, can I do analytics or can't I? Now, just for doing the analytics part of it, you don't need to know programming. There are many good products. If you know how to operate them, you can get away finding good answers, good solution to your forecasting needs. But if you really want to be an expert in analyzing any given data, then you better know some of the programming languages which are widely used, apart from knowing how to operate these products. So several programming languages, Python, R, Julia, these are the languages. I just mentioned Julia because that is what is the latest. Just like any other language, it may become the biggest hit, or it may just become one of the Me Too languages and it may go away. But these are the languages today which are popular. Of course, there is always C, which is no longer a go-to language, unless you are really developing some hardcore stuff. But otherwise, Python is the most preferred language, followed by R. If you know, and Python is very easy to learn too, so you could definitely get into learning that. Software products, definitely you need to leverage the advantages of what is already available instead of reinventing the wheel. So you need to know them. There are several situations where standard techniques cannot be applied. If you depend only on a tool or a product, sometimes in the extreme situations you may not be able to do the analysis, and so coding becomes necessary there. How do you go about learning? Top down, you start with mathematics and statistics and start looking at sampling theory and then get into applying that, and then one by one you learn everything and ultimately you are an expert. And then you start applying it, you start using real data and start analyzing it. What is the other alternative and which I prefer is the iterative method. You learn something, try to immediately implement it in, you know, either in an application, take a small sample from any of the sources you have on the net, apply it in either a program or in a product, see how it operates, learn, and then go to the next topic and so on. So this iterative learning is a better option than top-down, but this is an opinion, of course. Different people prefer a different way of learning. So I prefer the iterative way. But what you cannot ignore is just learning how to operate a product is not going to take you anywhere. You need to understand what is happening underneath. May not be in detail, but at least the concepts. So don't ignore the math aspect of it. That is really important. And that is where we come to the mathematics. Now, I'll tell you practically what happens. Everyone joins my course in IISc. A lot of people join with a lot of enthusiasm, assuming that they would become a fundamental data scientist by the end of the course. And the moment in the first class I start to teach them probability theory, next class half of them vanish. Believe me, this basic mathematics is absolutely important to understand why data science works and how data science works. So you need to be good in math if you want to be really good scientist, data scientist, if I can use that term. You can be a data operator without knowing anything, just by learning how to operate a tool, you can be a data operator. But if you want to be really good at data science, you better be good in all this: probability, linear algebra, and the common sense aspect of it, what I was talking about. Also requires a lot of calculus, basic knowledge, what is a minimum, what is a singular point in a continuous function. So these are all the stuff which you better know and understand, so that the techniques of data science make more sense to you. Going forward, always, I keep repeating this, I know I spoke about this, but always relate the mathematical aspects to the physics of the data. So you need to understand physical situation, what is actually that data, what does it mean? It is not just a number, it means something. The temperature means how, what is the temperature in Bangalore? It is not just a number. It influences, let us say, the pressure of the air, the atmospheric pressure, which in turn influences how high airplane can fly, and so on. So these are all related data. There is a physics associated with this number. So you should understand that really well come up with a good analysis of data. I told you about spurious correlation. That is the wave height of Arabian Sea and population of Portugal. I can give any number of examples of how people have failed by ignoring certain aspects, but that itself can take up an hour. I'll skip that. I have given one example. So I just could not help but put this statement from Disraeli. There are three kinds of lies, damn lies, and statistics. So statistics, just by using statistics, as I said, you can come to a wrong conclusion. At the same time, deliberately you could go and misrepresent facts. So in order to identify such misrepresented facts, we need to know a lot of probability statistics and the underlying math. You need to know what to look for. For example, if someone says, I'm forecasting some value, let us say somebody says, the number of people who will die out of corona at the end of May is one number. You should always go one step further and say, with what confidence? So there are certain other aspects, because they would have sampled some data and predicted that. So there is always a an element of uncertainty and there is a confidence level to that prediction. So you need to understand that, and that is where I urge you. It's a simple, very small book by Daryl Huff, How to Lie with Statistics. If you have an access to this, or if you can buy it, it's not very expensive either. You should, it's worth having book, you know. It's that sort of a book which you would want to own. It's a very simple, extremely well written with a lot of pictures, How to Lie with Statistics. It is not to teach you how to lie. It is to more from the point of how you can identify when someone else is giving you a wrong level of statistics. So coming back to artificial intelligence or machine learning or data analytics. So what is AI? Now this is a picture which I just picked up from the net because it gives practically all the branches of AI. So I will not go through every small thing here, but machine learning, natural language processing, and I am assuming that includes natural language generation, which is the latest stuff, expert systems, robotics, computer vision, which includes image recognition. So these are all the aspects of AI which are currently being exploited for a variety of uses, variety of domains, variety of situations in life. These are being used. So which are the algorithms behind this? We have supervised learning, unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning. I'm not allowing for annotation, sorry. Let me finish. You can ask all questions, and if there is an error in my presentation, you could definitely point it out later on. Please don't annotate; it will just spoil the flow of our flow of the topics. So, supervised learning is we give a test to a machine, and also give what is the expected output. Okay. So during the learning phase, the machine has the input data and the output as if there is a supervisor who is telling, yes, whether it is right or wrong, whatever the machine output is, whether it is right or wrong. And so it is called a supervised learning. So we have classification, we have regression, we have unidirectional graph, random forest, neural networks. These are all the supervised learning techniques. Okay. Within classification and regression and all, we have all those topics, naive Bayes, least square, the support vector machines, and so on. These are all the supervised techniques. What comes next? The unsupervised one, clustering, then the dimensionality reduction, the genetic algorithms. And what is new is the swarm intelligence. Now, a lot of research is going on. What is swarm intelligence? You look at the picture there. Each dot is a living being, an insect probably, a bird. If you have seen a swarm of bees or a birds flying in a formation, you see that they are a fish, a shoal of fish. Moving in a very specific formation, and when the fish in the head at the head of this swarm moves to the left, the entire the trail there moves in the same direction. That is, that phenomenon is exploited now in identifying very small components, and then arranging them such that they are all having some shared intelligence and they move towards what is ultimately needed. So swarm intelligence, these are all the unsupervised learning techniques which are some of them are old, they've been there through ages, some of them are new, they're coming on Very well. Now, what is the most important thing which attracts a lot of attention is natural language processing, natural language generation, which is NLG, computer vision. All this ultimately have what we call as artificial neural networks somewhere in the background. Now, many of the topics which I mentioned earlier, they are all techniques, and you can assume them to be components in a complete solution. So a complete solution may have all of them together, or a few of them together, or just one individual component together by itself. So ultimately, machine learning can use all these together to come up with a solution to a problem. So artificial neural network is one such very important thing which is gaining, which has gained a lot of importance in the recent past, and of course, a lot of new enhancements are being done to solve more and more complex stuff. This just gives what we call a perceptron, which is just, you know, this one, the first circle here is called a neuron. It has several several inputs, x1 up to xn. It has n inputs. Each of these inputs has an associated weight. There is some constant, I'll come to that, that's known as a bias. All this weighted sum of this, that is w1 x1 plus w2 x2 plus etc. wn minus 1 xn minus 1 plus wn xn, the sum of that goes into this as the input, and this goes through a function. We call that as an activation function. In the figure, you see a step function there, and you come out with an output. And whatever is the output is called as y cap. What is expected is y, and this value of c is our cost function. Now, ultimately, we go and minimize the cost functions. So this ultimately becomes an optimization problem, which is why I said mathematics is important. It is not just one aspect. A lot of things, calculus comes into this, and you know, maxima and minima, and that gets extended to linear programming and non-linear programming and all, where linear algebra and other associated stuff comes in. So we are going to minimize this cost function, which means when I'm saying minimize this, we are trying to bring the forecasted value of y, which is y cap, as close to y as possible. And how do we do that? We go and modify all these weights. The input remains the same. For this input, y is the expected output. Computer, the neural network is just the difference between my output and the expected output becomes low. And that is how a neural network works. A more typical neural network would look like this. And you know, these are known as deep networks. Deep means if I have some layers in between. This is the input layer, the first layer. This is the output layer. And in between the input and output layers, I have several hidden layers. All of them are connected. And each of these lines is associated with a weight. So you can imagine how many number of weights we would have in order to solve a practical problem. And we are going to modify each one of these weights such that the cost function becomes minimum. Okay. So at every step, we will be modifying hundreds of weights. And that is where the computational power comes into picture. That is where the efficiency of our optimization algorithm comes into picture. And you know, we go and train the net with the training data. Once we have minimized the cost function, that is, all the weights have been finalized using all the training data, the network is set to be trained. You can send in any value after that, and we get an output which is very close. I don't know how many of you have seen in the airport, in Bangalore airport and a few other airports as well, the Vistara Airlines had introduced a face recognition facility where you register your face. There is a scanner which scans your face, and then you type in your flight details and your seat number and stuff. Then you can walk in. The next stage where somebody is checking your credentials, you can just walk in because the machine again snaps your face, compares it with whatever is there in the database, and it recognizes your face and associates that with the flight and the gate and the seat number and so on, and you can walk through. Now, someone asked, can I explain neural networks once again? See, it is difficult to teach you neural networks in this session, but just to give you a very high level picture of it. Each of these is a node. Each of these has a function associated with it, which is called activation function. The one thing which you saw in the previous slide was a step function. This is known as a step function or binary function. Binary step. Now, nobody uses that because of some issues in that. What we normally use is a sigmoid function. And what is, you know, recently what is being used is known as a ReLU, you know, a rectified linear unit. It is something similar to a half wave rectifier. So the output is equal to the input if x is greater than zero, and it is equal to zero if x is greater than zero. That is what is used as a activation function. Each of this has an activation function. The input to each node is the weighted sum of input from each of the previous nodes. It goes through the activation function, and there is a rule about what should be the output. That would be the output from this node, which goes as the input to the next node multiplied by the weight of this node, and so on. It keeps going. Each of these layers identify generally a unique feature of the input data. Let us assume that you are training to identify faces. So some of the nodes, you know, I'm talking about what we today call as a convolution neural network. There are convolution layers which can identify specific features like nose, ears, eyes, forehead, and stuff like that. So all the components of a face are dissociated into features. Each layer is trained to identify a feature. And ultimately, the output layer would identify in some way, it will become ultimately a number. In some way, it identifies a unique face. Now, if the same face comes up in the next, phase, it will identify again, it will try to see, it will get a number ultimately. It will try to match that number against what it has been trained and identifies that as the nearest number and gives out that face, you know, whatever we were training earlier, gives out that face as the correct output. So in a sense, that is how a neural network works. If you really want to understand neural networks, there is a textbook on neural network written by a person called Fawcett, F-A-W-S-E-T-T. So Fawcett is the author. You could refer that. It's a fantastic book to start learning neural network. Okay, all the concepts are explained extremely well. Of course, if you want to go into the mathematics of that, mathematics of computer vision and so on, you could read the book written by Bishop, but then you need to be really good in math to understand Bishop. Fawcett is something which anyone, a layman, can understand. So going forward, where are these neural networks applied? Sir, please alert me if I'm running out of time, because if I start talking, you know, I would forget the time.
Sure, sir. We have around 15 minutes of time, so you can continue.
Okay. I'll try to cover as much as possible. So where are these neural networks applied? Signal processing, pattern recognition, speech synthesis, forecasting and prediction. Forecasting and prediction to a limited extent, more on the neural networks are more on not regression but on classification front. Forecasting is mostly regression, so to a limited extent where you could use this as well, but I would prefer if the data is conducive, forecasting and prediction, control and automation, radar interpretations, brain scans, they're all image related stuff. Stock market prediction is a very, well, again, these are, you can apply it, but there are better mechanisms for that. Optimization, etc. These are all the things, and there is a, I picked it up from one of the sort of more technical presentations. So it is a special issue on artificial neural networks, October 1996. You will get a lot more details on this. There is something called GAN, generative adaptive networks. So what it refers to is you are pitting two artificial machines against each other, and each one does not recognize if the other one is a machine or a human. For example, it's an interaction. So there is a generator, there is a real data sample, and this discriminator should actually identify whether it is a generated data or a real data, and then it gets fine-tuned. Where is it used? Now, look at these photographs. One is a real photograph, the other is a generated one, okay? So it is entirely created by GAN. Actually, this photograph, the top right is the real one, and the bottom left is the real one, and the other two are generated. Of course, not just by these two inputs, generated with millions of other inputs. So a lot of generation, even art, you know, these GANs have been trained on art, okay? And they have generated some modern art. I mean, I didn't like them though, but you know, it is very close to what a modern artist would generate. So generative adversarial networks. So this is the generator, there is a discriminator, and it gets trained and can generate this sort of this high quality of images, high quality of artwork, and so on. The next topic I would want to talk about is the natural language processing and generation. Now, I just took the example of NVIDIA because this is what I have come across as one of the best examples. All this, you know, the data is fed into this application. The graphs are just, you know, simple computer generated graphs. These are business intelligence, not an issue. The numbers are business intelligence, not an issue. But look at the narration here. All these are generated by the computer. Nobody has given, and this gives the gist of whatever the data says. Okay, this is generated text, which is currently known as natural language generation, and natural language understanding is the other part. Okay, so I speak something, and there is a program which understands what I'm saying. I type something, there is a program which understands. Your chatbots, for example, are classic examples of natural language understanding. And together, they are known as natural language processing. Again, these are all dependent on a lot of First of all, research, which is done on that. A lot of data is already analyzed, English and French and so on. And what we call as a corpus has been generated, which you can use to learn. And those are used in identifying all this. And behind the scenes, there is an artificial neural network which is running to do a part of it. There is a hidden Markov model which identifies a few other things and so on. So ultimately, it is, you know, all these techniques are applied in understanding and generating the text. So it all started with the Canadian Parliament, because they have English and French, two languages. Now, it was not started there, but that is where it kicked off into some serious research, because the transcripts had to be given in both the languages. If a person speaks in English, it had to be transcribed to French and the other way. So there were a lot of manual translators, and they wanted to replace it by machine, and so, you know, a lot of research went in. And again, several universities in the US have sites where you find programs and data, everything available for free for us to learn and experiment. And, you know, Professor Manning, if you have heard of him, he has written a book on NLP. It's a Bible. Professor Manning, M-A-N-N-I-N-G. So that is the place to go. One newspaper in US also generated sports. I'll answer that question. A sports section completely by machine, and nobody could make out that it was generated by machine. It is, you know, nowadays the technology is that advanced. Madam, I'll answer the question in a while. Let me quickly finish. These are the topics which you ought to know. Dataification is a trend where every aspect of our life is connected to data. So recently, people who were who used ATMs, for a while at least it happened, suddenly started getting messages from ICICI Bank that their ATMs are closer by and you could use them. You know, even though I used my HDFC Bank credit card to withdraw from ICICI Bank ATM, HDFC immediately recognized from my Google location through my smartphone that I was actually withdrawing money from some other ATM, not their own. And they sent me a message that there is a nearby HDFC ATM, why don't you use it? So every aspect of our life is now linked to data somewhere or the other. And that is known as datafication. I just cut and pasted the Wikipedia definition of datafication. So that is, you are getting data in all aspects, and hence that needs the analysis and analytics for making meaning out of it. And that is where we are heading to. Every aspect of our life gets into data. So some very quick dates. These are from some experts' analysis. You know, they have predicted, the world is changing so fast that these predictions will also alter every other day. So as we stand, these are some of the things which I could just pick up. Blockchain, 2023, which will become a big thing. Edge computing, mass science, such things. 2025, where smart, swarm robotics will come into picture. Quantum computing. Now that's another thing which is coming up in a big way. If you are interested, you should start right now to learn. There is, just like C#, there is a language called Q#, which is now available. IBM has started giving away time on their quantum computing for you to write programs and test, because it's their testing as well. So all the things which it'll come up, and quantum computing will force us to redo everything we have done till date. I won't get into quantum computing. In fact, I have just started learning. It's a bit complex. Again, a lot of mathematics in it, but it's really interesting. And if you want to be somewhere in the data science field, you better start learning quantum computing. Well, not necessarily data science, in computer, what do you say? What is it called? I forget. Pardon? To safeguard for your credentials, safeguard your data, all those stuff will need to be now in quantum, because a quantum computer can break all your passwords within no time. You know, in a few milliseconds, it can break your passwords. Nothing will be safe. So safety of your data and all that would require quantum computing, and much more. You know, it will be so fast that your data can be analyzed in a fraction of time which we take today. So opportunities are innumerable, believe me. Even today, forget about quantum computing and what is to come. Even with what we have today, we do not have enough people with knowledge of data science. There is a serious deficiency in that. And anybody who is half good at data science will definitely get a fantastic job opportunity. And believe me, you will enjoy data science like anything. So I am open for questions now. So there was one question: how do we decide weights? Now let me go back to the neural networks. Weights are decided by an optimization technique called gradient descent. Stochastic gradient descent is the optimization technique, because for your y cap, the only thing which can vary are the weights, because the input remains the same, the activation function remains the same. The only thing which you have control over are the weights, and so weights are decided by optimization. Now, how would you decide the number of neurons, number of layers? Well, that is from by practice. You do trial and error. Sometimes you overfit and then start reducing it and bring it to a stage where you can decide. So these are all the techniques which generally are used to decide on how many layers you have, how many neurons you have in that, and so on. Weights themselves are decided by the optimization technique. So I'll go.
So probably, sir, as we are on top of the hour, so what I could do is I could pick some relevant questions and read it out for you, and then you can answer it for us. So there is one question which says that how do you differentiate data science and data mining? There are some universities which teach these two as separate subjects.
Data mining, if you really look at my first slide, data mining is a part of the data storage and retrieval part of it, the retrieval part of it. Basically, you have a lot of data and you should actually pick the right data for your current problem, to solve your current problem. Data mining is a topic where you go and actually mine the data out of a lot of other data which are not relevant in the context which you are analyzing. So data mining is a specialty. It requires many of the related topics of data science. So the focus will be on the databases and how to retrieve the data and how to retrieve the optimal data out of it. Whereas data science is a bit more generic. It includes everything and probably a bit of data mining, a course on data mining as well. They are related, but not the same.
Thank you, sir. So probably the next question, I would be combining a couple of questions. So how do we ensure the accuracy of data collected? And between Python and R, which one do you pick for text analytics? And is knowledge of Python sufficient only for data analytics?
Okay, let me answer all that. And sir, thank you for combining that. They're all related. How do we do the accuracy of data? So there are techniques to do some data cleansing. You know, data acquisition is fine. You acquire the data and put it in the database. Before you do the analysis, we definitely need to cleanse the data, remove all those data which are, let us say, obviously wrong. Let's say we need a number and you get a letter instead, you know, alphanumeric instead of. So these are the sort of data which you can definitely clean. There are other techniques, statistical techniques of cleaning up data, or if there is missing data, there are ways to either fill it up, or you know, there are ways to decide whether you ignore it or whether you fill it up with the right thing, you know, or what to do. So data cleansing is a technique. So that can be done. But believe me, the quality of data is becoming more and more, is getting better and better as we have more and more advanced way of collecting the data itself. IoT, everything is automatic. So the chances of you getting a wrong data is very slim. Chances of you having gaps in the data is higher. So it is, there are ways to do that. And there is a concept of data generating function. I can't get into the details, unfortunately. So probably, the next opportunity I can talk about that. Sir, can you repeat the next part? The Python. Okay, whether Python is better, R is better, no, I can't say what is better. Personally, I prefer Python to R. There are advantages and disadvantages in both. Advantage of R is that it is a compiled language, so you get an object. If you are into a business of selling your software, you know, obviously you get an object and you can sell it without anybody getting into your source code. Python is an interpreted language, so you know, obvious disadvantages, the speed and all that. But you know, generally, the speed is not a big constraint as far as Python is concerned. It is easy to learn. It has all the features, many more features than, I don't say many more features, but many more advantages than R. I was discussing this with a person from Michigan State University, University of Michigan. A person called Daniel DeSouza, and his opinion was Python is the language to go for. But again, if you ask someone else, that person may have a preference for R, so it is a matter of opinion. My opinion, Python is a better one.
Thank you for that. Yeah, so thank you for the detailed answer, sir. So the next question would be with respect to artificial neural networks. As you are mentioning about the assigning the weights, are weights in artificial neural networks chosen randomly, or do we have a techniques to assign these weights?
Oh, to start with, you just assign any random weight. We all start with something which is same for all the weights, either 0 or 1, and then within a couple of iterations, they would have come very close to what you need.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is seems like mainly from a student. What should be my next course after neural networks and deep learning to enhance my knowledge in data science? And which platform allows us to know more about data science? Kind of tutorials to learn the concept?
Okay. Data science, as I said, is a vast subject. Even data analytics, if you say, it's so big that no one person can be an expert in all. So you should choose. Are you interested in natural language processing and generation? Are you interested in computer vision? Are you interested in data mining? So it all depends on your interest. Okay. So you choose any one of these topics and become an expert in it. Do not try to be, try to get into every aspect of it. You just can't study everything. You cannot be an expert in everything. Choose your topic. There are several online courses in IISc. There are several classroom weekend courses at IISc if you are already a graduate. If you are not, my suggestion is you go to the go to net. If you Google, you'll find a lot of courses. Probably, do not get distracted by too many sites. If you start learning the same concept in multiple sites, the chances that you will learn, you will get confused is very high. So start with one, and if it is a paid channel, that will be the best, because they will maintain consistency across all the topics and they will teach in a very structured way. If you cannot afford paid courses, there are several free courses you can start. So start at the very fundamental and continue in the same stream or the same provider, so that you know your knowledge is consistent. That's my only. But the sources are innumerable. If you get on the net, you'll find a lot of very good courses available.
Thank you, sir. As we are on top of the hour and we have extended 10 minutes, I will go for one last question and then probably we can wrap it up. So this is more on entrepreneurship and the existing business opportunities. So what are the opportunities in data science when it comes to entrepreneurship domain, and how data science can serve as a stable model in some existing businesses?
Believe me, every business today has a need for data science. It could be a retail shop, it could be an extremely complex business, it could be aerospace, it could be a software company who specializes in data science, themselves need data science. So any aspect of it, believe me, any field of business in our day-to-day living, you will find a need for data science. So if you are interested in providing service, data service to enterprises, to small business, to educational institutions, for example, you think of it, they will have a need. So the scope is extremely wide. The only caution I would give is you need to be extremely good in data science. Do not depend on software which is available. Let's say everyone uses SAS. Now, believe me, SAS is a fantastic product. But if you do not understand data science, you would not, you may know how to feed the data into this and get the output. If you do not understand the underlying things which are going behind your behind the scenes, if you do not understand what the output means. You know, I have seen big people present, make big presentations without understanding the output of a SaaS. You know, it was in that particular case, it was a SaaS output. Without understanding the meaning of it, it leads to a disaster. So if you're good in data science and you use licensed versions of, let's say, good softwares, you can definitely thrive. And if you build your own software, that is even better. You know, there is ample scope for you and 20,000 others to serve the market which is available only. But if you have opportunities outside, there is no limit to that. It is that big today.
Thank you, sir. That was very insightful answers that you have provided. And again, once again, on the behalf of IEEE Bangalore section, I would like to thank you for sparing the time with us. Before we conclude, do you have any last remarks, especially for our students who are keen on data science?
Yes, you know, I'm sorry to have glossed over many things which, you know, which are interesting and important in data science. I have very limited time. But my suggestion is, please learn the basics. Learn the basics well. Do not forget the mathematics which you have learned in your engineering. That is one thing which I find in my class at IISc. The first thing I do is to take, you know, some 10 hours to brush up their mathematical skills. So do not forget that. Know, realize that that is the most important aspect. Learn the techniques, but remember common sense, perseverance, and collaboration to be successful in data science. Of course, you will obviously learn the techniques and the technology of data science. And if you need any advice, any more information on any of these topics, you know, I'm available. Whoever asks for, you can share my mail ID. I'll be happy to answer their questions.
Sure, sir, we will do that. And a note for all the participants, please do join us for tomorrow's session on graduate studies in engineering in US by Dr. Sudha Kumar. We would once again like to thank Dr. Gopal Krishna Sharma for spending his valuable time with us and sharing his insights on data science. Thank you, sir. We would be concluding it for today and see you all tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.